Good morning to each and all, and it's a pleasure to be here amidst so many bright young minds who are the future of this country. I thought the way we'd go about this is to tell you a little bit about our goals as an architect. And I think that for people involved with managing and planning and taking decisions, what's important is sometimes not the final outcome, but the process. Of course, we want certain goals to be reached at the end, and that will happen. But it's the way we get there also that matters. So having said that, we'll just quickly jump. Thank you, Steve, for those very kind words. Thank you for your hospitality, Garden City. It's been amazing. So we began our practice with no godfathers. We began as two young architects in this city, not knowing anybody. And this was our first project, a little house. But I think the reason I'm showing you this is because it really wanted to address the climate of this city. And look at what does house type mean to build contemporary houses in Bangalore. This was in 1995, I think. But what did it mean in terms of light, in terms of really understanding the intricacies of climate? And I think when you get and start asking yourself critical questions, you'll find solutions which may not have been before. And that's, I think, the path that we all need to take, which is to ask those critical questions and take a path which has not been charted before, not for the sake of doing it, but because you're asking questions and maybe those answers are required in that. So very quickly, you can see blank walls on this side, right? You see two garden courts. And all of this has risen from our understanding of the way the wind moves in a given, in our city of Bangalore, in the way light functions. How do you pick up light in a climate where for 6 months near you have dull, cloudy weather? And where do you position your courts? And all the decisions of architecture, what I'm trying to say is that nothing is arbitrary. It's a very thought out process. And you examine, how do you even ornament a building? Is a building meant to look like a pastry? Or does the ornament derive from a deeper structural understanding? So you'll see that ornament is very restricted and restrictive in a way, but that is the beauty of the, is what we were trying to highlight. So this is the second house that we did. And again, it talks about the southwest and how the southwest needs to be largely wall surface because the heat of the sun is the most. And the eastern side can be opened up a little more because you get a beautiful draft of wind from the southwest northeast. So you see basically understanding and not assuming, you know, understanding by asking questions. So this house actually had won a lot of international acclaim. And also questioning in a house, how does a family, how does a home store its memorabilia? You know, where do you build showcases or can everything be intrinsic to the project itself? Yes, the veranda on the southwest again. So you create these shaded zones. You know, if you look at traditional Indian architecture, you get a lot of clues from there in terms of where you need shade. How does that understanding is something that very often has been lost because we're in a time when you can build and do anything with any material. Everything's available. So it's important, therefore, to ask questions of appropriateness. And yes, this is jumping again to the next project. It was a little church that we did in a little neighborhood where every house touches the other. So it was a very nondescript ad hoc neighborhood. But we wanted to make a place that would give a little more sense of a public, semi-public space in a neighborhood, and therefore how do you make that? So we literally, the entire setbacks of the project have been given to the street. And this particular church holds charity clinics and things like that. So that whole zone actually gets animated, has a life of its own. So the building recesses back. I'll come to the building later. But it's very interesting that when we built it, we said no walls. But you know, 10 years down the line, the clients themselves feel like they feel insecure without the walls. So I think these are questions we have to ask. You know, can we remain and impact our neighborhood in such ways that we don't feel threatened and have to build walls and make ourselves insulated? You know, what are the institutions that can afford to open its boundaries to the street and begin a dialogue? So you see that the actual sanctuary, it's a Baptist church, which means they have no religious symbolism. They have no iconography, no idols, nothing. So for them, the church is not a holy building. It's just that the body of believers, you know, are, you know, what matters. So we've lifted the sanctuary where they pray above the street level. So you have to climb up those steps. And that's the door leading to the outside threshold, which I showed you. Next, please. This is how the sanctuary looks. We've only worked with light, sunlight, to ornament the space. So this was a building, I'm going to make it very brief because it's quite architectural, where the client is a collector of art and wanted privacy. And because of the amount of original art he has, you cannot allow the natural light to fade the colors, etc. So what we developed, and he has three businesses, one of which is explosives and etc., etc. So what we did is the concept was to create individual identities for the three businesses, separated by cuts of light. This is what it looks like on the outside. Very simple. We believe that each project needs to be appropriately expressed. So everything does not have to shout and scream, you know? Sometimes you want something that totally blends into the environment. You don't see it. But when you enter, there's magic inside. So I think some kind of projects need to be very iconic and stand up and shout and say, here I am. So these questions, again, I want to emphasize, need to be asked. Yes, so you see that this space here, you see a lot of light there, and you see light at the other end, at the far end. So these are those little interstices of space that I showed you on the plan. Cuts of light going from top to bottom, ceiling to floor, as a result of which there's been so much of an ambient light in the space that the office closes by 5:30, and they only used about 30% of what was sanctioned as electrical consumption. So this idea actually was generated because as we walked on areas like Commercial Street and things, we saw buildings cheek by jowl with tiny little corridors where all the movement happens. So that was really inspiration for this. You see a lot of reflections and diffractions. You can see right through, in a way. There are three blocks, but these are all the gap spaces. You can see right through, create long vistas. I'm going to run through it a little fast because this was for an architectural audience. So we'll move a little faster. So here you see the interstice of space, animating the space, only natural light. This is what we have richly in this country to work with. This is a very dear project to me because we love the process. We actually researched for about maybe 6 months before we actually designed. And it's the Bhopal gas tragedy site. I don't know how many of you are familiar with it, 1984. And basically it's a landscape where, to even present day horror, you cannot really touch the land because what's happened is the soil is contaminated. And now, because that has not been cleaned over these last, 20, 30 years, it's leached into the ground and affected the groundwater, so it seems like a never-ending problem. So our focus was really to say that we cannot build a memorial on this site unless the site is cleaned. So we don't want to see a mausoleum there, but really the whole process needs to be part of the act of coming to terms with it and being rejuvenated. So what we did was we said it has to be tested at grids of every 25 meters, test pits dug, and then we figure out the levels of contamination, and we remove the earth wherever there is contaminated soil, which has to be taken to another sealed landfill area. So what you see, therefore, in the ground would be pockets of earth, like scars, like scars of a landscape. That's what you see here. So it's a very pitted, scarred landscape. And what we did was, because we were scooping into the earth, we thought we'd build a few underground structures where people-oriented programs, like clinics, free clinics, free rehabilitation, economic programs, because the people are still suffering, you know? And things which are people-related could actually happen at a sort of a subsurface level. And the actual ground zero, which was where the actual tragedy began, would be hollowed out as two courtyards. So it was a very choreographed, planned movement. You'd move from one, you'd start at the lower level, you'd enter through all of these little things, access all of the programs whenever you had need. Then you emerge on the upper landscape, you go to these two, and you emerge once more in a green orchard. So it was all to do about how do you collect clean water? How do you still come back and touch clean earth and not worry that your kids can play there? How do you create memory, you know, of things like this? How does the human mind forgive and forget and move on? How does healing happen? So these were all questions that we were addressing through this. So these were the strategies I've already explained. The idea of the displaced landscape, cleanup area, scars, water collection. Could some of these areas be used to collect clean water? And rejuvenation, finally, when you just come through. And a lot of activities that we brainstormed could be a possible need for these people. Next, please. Next, please. So you see, these were models made. Yeah, these were all clay models made. So we sort of really explored what potential this had. Next, please. And then the whole irony of the fact that if you plant trees on the old contaminated soil, you know, maybe you cannot eat the fruit of it. So basically, in each of these scars, that you literally have to prop up an island and put fresh, clean soil and then grow your trees, you know? So just tongue-in-cheek spatial suggestions. This is basically the two courtyards, constructed very differently. But one is dealing with the pain and the jagged memory, the scars, the loss. The second one is more a place of release. And you come out and you can come out onto fresh terrain. Next, please. Just views. We can go through this a little quickly. Next. Light, how you take light in. You know, light is such an ornament. You do not need decoration on a building. You can just really work with this, whether it's quiet and spiritual or it's something very busy, exciting, you know, the stage setting for a fashion show. You can really play with light if you know how to use it. And as architects, we all need to learn how to use it. The reason I'm actually sharing this with you, I know this is quite architectural. Maybe some of it is seemingly irrelevant. But I think that as when you commission work, you know, if you're a client or you're in a committee, you're commissioning work, I think to have a broader vision is very, very important. Because otherwise, what you'll get are nice, fancy-looking pastries which have no meaning except its outer elevation. I mean, you peel that off, there's nothing inside. The experience is nothing. So I think it's important for us, even as we come together as different disciplines, that we have an understanding of what is appropriate, maybe. This is the last courtyard. And yes, this is a project that is also underway and is maybe 60% complete. And was actually, we won this in a national competition. It was a two-stage competition. We won the project. And basically, it's the old, I think Steve briefly mentioned it, it's the old central jail of Bangalore, which is now converted into an urban park. And the most wonderful thing was that they gave us the freedom to figure out what the park needed to have, and that was very exciting. So I think when you're a stakeholder in the city and you have the choice to do that, to rather than saying, well, why don't we say this should happen, instead to open it up to discussion and see what can come about, and then you pick what works best for everybody. So if you look at this, the old plan, you see these radial wings, which is and a central tower here. That's the typical jail plan. In this case, it happens as open blocks in a landscape. It's called the panopticon prison typology, which means basically the idea of observation, and everything else stems from the central observation point, which when you go to Freedom Park is, you see these two walls, right? So these two walls are actually a long set of maybe about 100 meters, where you walk, you're between two parallel walls, you see nothing but the watchtower in front of you. So you can imagine the psychology of a prisoner who's walking in or walking out from there. It's tremendous, you know? So it's a beautiful, very poignant sort of a built construct. and we had to make intervention. So obviously our first thing was we cannot erase this memory of what it was. And so of course there were some buildings which were in a very dilapidated condition, and the BBMP, which was our client, said that that has to go. So what we did was we, on the sketch you see, what we did was we kept the memory of that, which means that some of them are only plinths in the landscape, showing the beds on which the prisoners, you know, slept. Some of them are just garden beds, but when you go there, you can read what was the old pattern instead of completely erasing it, you know? So, and the second thing we did was that we tied new elements, which were like sculptural markers, very simple things, just there was one curved wall, there's a round form, very, very elemental forms are anchored to the old structure, so that you can see clearly what is old and what is new. And we changed the movement so that you discovered the old memory, but you walked through the new. So there were some strategies of movement there. And the old buildings, our strategy was only one thing, that we should find what, remove all the ad hoc interventions and come back to what was the original and then use that as a starting point. So this is the old hospital block. I'll just explain this very quickly, that there was a roof, which was a pitch roof, very dark. So what we did was we retained the entire shell. We added two elements here, which you see in red. We added two markers onto the old, and we changed the roof form, inspired from this, but to create a new skyline. So this is the parallel walls. It's a very compelling experience. And the old and the new were treated very differently in terms of color, lighting, texture, etc. So you see now here, you see the new, and you see the old, you can see the contrast, and the idea is to allow people to read history, you know, not to remove one layer and build another one so we have no idea of what's happening 50 years down the line. This is the block I told you about with the new roof form that was formerly the hospital block, which has now become an exhibition hall, etc. And this is what I was talking about, even where the barracks could not be retained, that you have the memory of it, you know, so they can be used as various, you can discover it. It brings some question to your mind. It's to engage with history. This is an exhibition that happens there almost every year, which animates the whole thing and brings it to life. This is our own office, and I'm just going to talk about the idea here. The lower part is a house, and the upper part is an office. So it's a mixed-use development. But the whole idea was really to, as an architect's office, to engage with your neighborhood. So we've actually created a little spectator box where it's completely glass, you engage with your street. Even at this point, you engage with your street. So the idea is that we cannot disengage ourselves as architects or as anyone. We cannot disengage ourselves from street life, from the society that happens around us. And how do you make gestures? How do you, whether it's a large-scale project where you're dealing with connecting different museums or whatever it is, or something as small as a single house or a single office, how can you engage with your urban environment? So again, questions of how do you orient buildings? These are two twin houses where we've actually got a beautiful east orientation, and we've just made two sun caps over the buildings. And you see this side is longer than this side. That side is longer than this side. That's only a reflection of how the sun works in that area, where you want to shut out the southwest sun, south-southwest sun, and so the cap extends a bit lower there and creates more shade into the living spaces of the houses. Both the buildings actually connected with a strip of water. So I think the aspect of beauty is secondary to the whole thing, and that's what I want to say, that it's important for us to ask questions, and everything else will fit in. And of course, being an architect, beauty and aesthetics is important. That's part of our thinking. So that's always secondary. You don't start by saying, my building is going to look like this. You explore, you question, and then you get to the solution. Right, this is also interesting because it deals with old and it deals with new. And you can see that the old, the new is wrapping around the old, leaving fragments of the old for us to see. So here is an example of an old parish hall at the St. Mark's Church campus, which has great memory and values for these for the congregation. And when they wanted a resource center and various facilities, we decided to just leave that intact, leave fragments of it and work around it. Again, contrasting between old and new. And this that you see has been introduced in this configuration only so that they catch a glimpse of that old 18th century church building. So it's almost like you're trying to connect with the purpose for which all these facilities are happening. This is a project again which shows an old Dutch house in Cochin, Fort Cochin area, which was completely, by the time we got it, had been added to, and you know, a lot of things had happened. And so we wanted to honor the old structural system of that, so we really worked within the roof, and you can see this little slit of light we've made there. That's all we did to that. We strengthened it, and next piece, we added a mezzanine inside. I'll explain what that is. So these are views. This is a mezzanine. This was the old structure. We've added a little floor in a manner that does not confuse the person in the space, knowing that that happened later and this was the old. So that's what we've done. Basically, three exclusive boutique rooms in Fort Cochin. Next, please. That's the light you see now coming in from the top. Next, please. This is how the room layout is. A bathroom outdoors and, a washing area, bathing area, etc. A bed space here with a mezzanine. This is, I think, the last project on our presentation. And this was for the National Martyrs Memorial. Opposite the planetarium site, this is the site opposite Raj Bhavan and in the Gandhi musical fountain area. So this was a large park, and it was in the public eye because there was a lot of protests, public protests against the organizers, etc. But finally, it's been built, and we've had the privilege of not cutting a single tree except for eucalyptus trees. So I think it is what you set out to do and that you fight for that. So the entire building has emerged, the plan of it has emerged from this one goal. So this is the site. I'll just explain the elements of this. So basically you see a park, and what we've done is we've cut into the park a long ceremonial strip of space, which is going to have this martyr's stone. Karnataka used to call it the Veera Gallu, okay, which is or the brave stone. So all those who died are remembered. People can place wreaths here, the national flag, and an underground museum. So this is all you see. The park is just cut with the pathway and these elements, and that's the end of what you see. And then you begin your museum walk below with memorial plaques there. So you look at this very organic plan, and none of it was arbitrary, because all of these are trees. That's how this whole thing has derived. And tree roots, rather. And you see, this is the main means of ventilation. We have these diagonal courtyards which bring in light and ventilation into this underground memorial or motivation hall for the youth. So this is just showing that it's completely underground. You have the diagonal courtyards going up, bringing light, everything used for display. And you see the connection between that and this. So some views and the kind of time it takes to develop details like this. My partner, who's also my husband, Shomitro, is extremely good at detailing, and that's his passion. So some of these details have taken hours, you know, to just really resolve, get it right. So it's a work of love, I think, you know. Every building needs to be a work of love for it to express itself adequately. The cutouts, these are all pictures when it was not finished, but you see what's been done below. You see the triangular courtyards here. It also goes up diagonally that way in the other direction. And these also become the fire escape routes in case of something. Cutouts to get light in. And eventually this will be quite animated with large-scale models of, aeroplanes and things like that, fighter planes. So that brings us to the end of this work. And it's been an amazing... We started in 95, so it's been about 19 years of practice. And we started, like I said, I've grown up in Bangalore, and I came back to Bangalore after my studies, but we started with literally no one to recommend us, give us projects, you know. We started as two young people just scrambling about a bit, but the expression of all of this work is just the faithfulness of God. Just the faithfulness of God. It's been amazing, you know. And I would have to say thank you, Jesus, for that, because it's been every step of the way. The more you give and he controls it, the better. You know, it's been amazing the way we've got projects, Freedom Park was threatened a million times. There was somebody wanted to build the world's tallest tower. There was someone wanted to do many, 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 many things, you know, which could have thwarted the vision from being realized to what it is. It's still not complete. But more than us saying, we will do it, it's saying, God, can you do it for us? Because God is faithful. And I want to say that because, you know, every project is, you know, sometimes as an architect, you're constantly thinking about new ideas. And there's a time when you get tired, you know, because you have no source to be inspired from, you know. So it's been amazing how God is such an inspiration. And I dedicate my entire body of work, yes. So I want to say that we all have that hope and help in God, you know. And as I think as management students, we're always trying, I mean, all of us, right? We're always managing things as human beings. And we want to always bring it under our control. You want to see that everything's happening, but I've learned just the opposite lesson, and I want to just say that in a second. It's good to do that. It's good to take everything that you know and bring it into a sum total of what you understand. But beyond that, to give it in the hands of God is just the most awesome thing you can do. He'll just take you from where you are and can take you right up there. So I want to leave that thought with you, you young people on the threshold of, you know, of a new life ahead of you. And with God, nothing is impossible. So thank you for this time, and I hope you enjoyed the work.